بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. My dear brothers and my sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. In this third installment about how to spot a funny husband, I will be in Allah lay down a few rules that will help you figure out where your marriage is. This is not a pre-marriage talk, i.e. I will not tell you how and what to look in a potential husband. This will be dealt in another pep talk, inshallah. But this one, once you are married and you have had kids and you kind of like fall into a certain routine, and then you start feeling somewhere deep inside you that things aren't as you have thought or as you would like them to be. And you see your husband coming in and out of the house, going to work, coming home, interacting, and that kind of stuff. And yet something deep inside you ain't right. And you start settling down. You start accepting realities and things like that. But a lot of couples sadly do not read the signs properly. And little do they know that small tiny mistakes will add up until one day they will cost the marriage a big deal of headaches and problems. Just like a business, usually businesses have a problem with the cash flow, and slowly until the business has big troubles and it goes into liquidation and bankruptcy. And before going in details, I would like to clarify something about marriage, that if we Muslims got an idea about it, then bi'idhnillah the marriage will be far better than what it is today. But why do I say Muslims? Why am I only referring to Muslims? Well, because the Western world and the advanced world, they rely on studies, researches, on psychology, on a lot of sciences to help them keep track of their relationship. But we Muslims, more than so, we rely on culture and some ahadith or the sayings of scholars to keep track of our relationship without using the current and fresh techniques, studies, discoveries, and all these things. We don't use them. It's kind of like it's for the other world. And as such, we fall into a lot of problems and a lot of traps that we could have avoided if only we understood the true meaning of a marriage. To you, my sister and my brother, if I ask you what marriage is, you're going to kind of like look at me with one eyebrow up and the other one really frowny. Kind of like, are you pulling our leg? But actually, I am not. Really, what does the term marriage mean? A lot of people understand, and even in our fiqh, if you could read Arabic and you picked up a book of fiqh, it will tell you that the الزواج شرعا هو استمتاع الزوجين كل بالآخر بغرض النكاح. It's the act of deriving pleasure from both partners and under a decree, and that is the marriage. So marriage is not an act of possession. And this is where you understand when the majority of people, especially in the Muslim world, as soon as somebody marries a woman, he straight away wants her to completely obey him and surrender everything to him. She becomes his possession. This is not how it is described in Islam. As I say, it's the act of deriving pleasure from each other, and with an act, obviously, the kids are a result to such enjoyment and pleasures, but they are not what the marriage is all about. I want to take you on a journey so you understand why marriage is a sacred relationship under Allah. My dear brothers and my sisters, marriage is a sacred institution, because it is very hard fact to fathom these days that everything on earth has been made halal and ready for us to use. I say hard to believe because there are tons of Muslim missionaries these days who are doing their very best at limiting the usage of everything on earth and turning it in a dreadful controlled life, even though the master, i.e. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, said in the Quran, هو الذي خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا. This is in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 29. He is the one, i.e. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the one who created and made everything on earth for us. i.e. everything on earth initially is halal, anything that you look at, unless and until there is something that tells you or prohibits you from doing that. It is well known between the scholars of Islam, these two golden rules, write them down. When it comes to life, everything is halal except what has been made haram in Islam. For example, initially, eating pig is halal, but then the Quran came and prohibited for us, and then it became prohibited. If Al-Quran didn't mention it, then we would be eating pork, and that is absolutely fine. On the other hand, also wine is halal, or was halal, and was drunk before. But nowadays, we need an evidence to make it haram, for us not to touch it. And as such, anything on earth today that is halal, and for someone to prohibit you from using it, then they need an evidence, a clear-cut evidence from Al-Quran, or the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ, that will stop us from using that thing there. On the other hand, anything in Islam, in the religion, is haram to do unless and until there is an evidence to do it. For example, Salat al-Dhuhr is 4. I cannot add 5 and say it's halal because I need an evidence to prove that it is 5 rakat and not 4. Basically, for anything to use on earth, everything is halal. You need an evidence to prohibit you from doing it. And when it comes to your act of worship, everything is haram and you need something to make it halal for you. So it is clear cut that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of everything on earth for us to use. And I call him our master. The reason why our master is one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as in Al-Adab Al-Mufrad of Imam Al-Bukhari alayhi rahmatullah, somebody told him, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Sayyidana, for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, do not call me your master, for Allah who was Sayyid, Allah is the master. So if you hear me say our master, is because it's an authentic hadith and we can use that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But anyway, so our master said that the universal fact is that everything on earth is halal for us. After ending the preparation of earth, our habitat for us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regulated the very first thing that was going to occupy the earth, how mankind would come to earth. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that it was going to be with the addition or the interaction between the male and the female. My dear brothers and my sisters, giving life to a human being is no easy job, or nor is a simple task. Animals are the nearest life givers to humans, but since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not equip them with intellectual choices, our master didn't ask of them to obey his laws. And since earth is primarily a home to a human being, animals are just here for our use, and they also are here to serve us, directly or indirectly, such as those we eat, those that protect us, like dogs, cats, and etc., and those that work day and night at keeping our ecosystem working for us. My dear brothers and my sisters, since animals are not required to worship Allah, they are then not required to follow the teachings found in the book of Allah. And here ends the similarity between animals and humans. We humans are a totally different ball game. For example, bees follow the same pattern all around the world. Wherever there are bees, they do exactly the same thing. The courting process and then the production system and all that kind of stuff. Dogs do the same thing. Tigers, animals, everybody of the world of animals follow the same pattern. But we humans, we do not follow any particular pattern, and this is what makes us completely different than anything else on earth. As I mentioned before, my dear brothers and my sisters, only humans have a soul. Anything else doesn't have a soul. Angels do not have soul, the jinn do not have a soul, and animals do not have a soul. The only ones that have been endowed with a soul are humans. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored us beyond belief. The term Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to introduce us, humans, to the angels is a very interesting word, and it opened gates upon gates to countless speculations. Look at this beautiful ayah. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. And this is Al-Baqarah, and the ayah is number 30. And when your Lord, your Rabb, said to the angels, I am making a khalifa in the earth. The angels had absolutely no clue what a Khalifa successor would look like. And this is why they had speculations about him shedding blood, because they thought it could be like the jinn. But it's just they didn't know what Allah didn't say a human being as such at that moment there. And the term Khalifa is a beautiful concept which carries more than a meaning. One of them is the successor. So if there is a king and someone succeeds him, so that's his Khalifa. And also the progeny that you left behind. So when someone dies and they leave kids behind, those kids are his Khalifa. And also if you send somebody or someone takes your place to enter and do acts that you usually do, like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when Rasulullah died, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu became the Khalifa, i.e. he succeeded Rasulullah both in the leadership and he was the first leader after the death of Rasulullah. So what Allah, our Master, revealed to the angels is that I am placing in the earth a new creation which, unlike you, the angels, he will be equipped to leave his offspring behind by means of reproduction, and who will also succeed one another in duties and functions, like establishing the law and so on and so forth. And since giving life, my dear brothers and my sisters, is a divine only function, no other can give life. This is why when we kill somebody, we have done the job of Allah, because no human has the right to take the life of somebody else. And when someone kills another human, is that they have shortened the life of this human without Allah's permission. And this is where the problems happen, and this is why we need to kill the killer and so on and so forth. But in any way, as I said, since giving life is a divine only function, the process that humans follow is nothing but just a step in the bigger divine process. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us indifferently that I create everything. So someone might say, huh, but Allah needs humans to trigger the process, and then Allah carries on. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has responded that that is not how it is. And to say that, he said, I created Adam without a father and a mother, i.e. I don't need anyone to start the process of creation. And then he created Hawa, Eve, from a man, but without a mother. And he created Jesus alayhi salam, a man, from a woman, without a father. And if Allah did it once, he can do it endlessly. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his divine wisdom, has chosen to make marriage the tool from which babies are made. Humans do not like the idea of other people crushing their private space or enter their own homes without their prior consent or invitation. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want anyone to invite any other person into this world without the permission of Allah first. That permission is the marriage. This is why when people commit fornication without proper marriage and the boy or the baby is born, that baby there is considered illegitimate because he came to the world without a permission from Allah through marriage. And this is why it is haram to fornicate, because it leads to bringing people to this world without a consent from Allah. And as I said, the ceremony for that consent is the marriage. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called marriage in the Quran mithaqan ghalidha, a robust covenant. And people who don't respect this covenant, they will respond to Allah on the day of judgment. Believe me, it is not an easy job. So people who are not really caring for the marriage, it's going to be very, very hard for them on one day. The human reproduction, my sister and my brothers, the human reproduction parts are haram on each other until we utter the name of Allah on them. And that uttering of Allah on them is the proper marriage ceremony as Allah wants it. Just like it is haram to eat a meat that the name of Allah has not been uttered upon, it also is haram to interact with the human meat at sexual level without uttering the name of Allah on it, to render it halal. And that uttering is the act of marriage. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran has explicitly said that there are four things that only Allah can do. No other human can do. Allahu alladhi khalaqakum, thumma razaqakum, thumma yumitukum, thumma yuhyikum. Allah is the one who created you, then provided for you, then will make you die, then will give you life again on the day of judgment. هَلْ مِن شُرَكَائِكُمْ مَن يَفْعَلُ مِن ذَلِكُمْ مِن شَيْءٍ. Are there any of your partners and those who are, you associate to Allah who can do anything of that? سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَىٰ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. He be exalted and high above all what they associated to Him. So as you can see here, Allah is the only one who creates. And He has, subhanahu wa ta'ala, chosen to make us humans part of that process. And this is a great honor. My dear brothers and my sisters, Allah does not need anyone, as I said, to help Him create humans. And He proved that when He created our father Adam without no father, no mother. He created our mother Hawa, Eve, without any mother through a father. And He created a man, Jesus alayhi salam, through a woman without a father. And as I said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done it once, He can do it endlessly. And that is what Allah can do, and even without humans at all, as in the case of Adam alayhi salam. But Allah chooses to do what He pleases, and we are here in that process called marriage. Neither Adam, my sisters, nor Eve, nor Jesus had a say or a choice in their own creation. Neither did you. You didn't choose your parents. You didn't choose the color of your eyes. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah alayhi rahmatullah says in the meaning that people show their true colors when it comes to their religion in two situations, at the time of marriage and at the time of death. And subhanAllah, you see a lot of people implying and implementing a lot of their culture as opposed to a lot of their religion. And my sisters and my brothers, a married couple is no simple couple. Wallahi al-Azim, if we knew that a married couple is not something simple, we would respect each other for eternity. This couple is mindfully and choicefully carrying on a divine duty. This is why, my dear brothers and my sisters, the success of marriage is the most lovable thing to Allah and the most hurtful to man's nemesis, and that is the inescapable agent of evil, a shaitan. Look, my dear brothers, I want you to understand something. For us humans, not being married is a problem. People will start asking questions. But for Allah, when they accused Him of providing a child, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't like it at all, hated it, and made the biggest shirk ever is to say that Allah has got a son. Because having a son is such an honorable thing for mankind, but not for a God. So for you to be part of the creation process, that is a very dignifying position you hold in Allah's sight. After all, Allah has sworn by parents, لا أقسم بهذا البلد, I do not swear by that city, that is Mecca. وأنت حل بهذا البلد, and you, Muhammad, you are one of the inhabitants of Mecca. ووالد, and a life giver for children, وَمَا وَلَدْ, and the children that they have given. Our master wants our marriage to succeed, my dear brothers and my sisters. But again, our enemy, الشيطان, doesn't want that at all. And this is why every single day, as in Sahih Muslim, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم says, إِنَّ إِبْلِيسَ يَضَعُ عَرْشَهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ. Iblis, at the end of each day, puts his throne on the water and sends his shayateen, his allies, to mankind. فَأَدْنَاهُمْ مِنْهُ مِنْزِلًا, the closest to him and the biggest causer of problems on earth is the one who separates between the family members, the man and the woman. And this is in Muslim, and Iblis considers such a doer a great asset and a great performer. As such, my dear sisters and my brother, the shaitan is always, always, always a war effort to hit the couple where it hurts most, separation. But how does he do that? How does he cause us to separate? And the reality, it doesn't happen overnight, but it's a long process. And the ally of shaitan is time. And here is what I am going to reveal to you, how you can gauge where you are now in your situation, your relationship, and how you can protect yourself and your husband and your children from the gloomy dragon, and that is divorce. So is your husband real or is he phony? First thing first, my dear sister and my brother, this is not an accusation. He is your husband. So the matter is, after you have made your choice, and this is not about helping you discover the real from the unreal and phony potential husband, but it is more to help you make up how you can improve your relationship with your husband now. Is your husband with you because of you, or because of your children, or because he has nowhere to go, or because he is comfortable where he is now, or? What it is, my sister, is that if your husband is comfortable where he is now, then things are not looking good for you, because they can't get any better. And if he has reached that stage there, is how, what can you do? And what, how can you do things so that you excite the relationship and get the ball back on track, the track of love? I will start now with a few pointers. I've chosen 10 for you that will help you keep an eye on the well-being of your couple. Point number one, list his best characteristics before marriage. Sit down, my sister, and make a list of what you liked about him before you married him. List everything about him and compare your list to who he is today. How much of the old him is present today? This list will help you figure out how much of his true personality exists and how much of it has gone. And this list, my sister, will also serve as a blueprint, as a business plan, or as a roadmap. It will help you find out if the man you once trusted and loved enough to marry is still the same or not. And please write down everything, because it will help you understand where you were, where he is, and where he is now, and where he is going to go. Because if you have been married to him, say, for 5 years, and you see, like, 2 years ago, he used to be this, but now he doesn't do that anymore, and he does this. So you can pretty much see in the next 5 years what he is going to become. And that will give you an idea on how you can work with your current situation to make it better. Point number two, communication. And this is one, general communication. Take a moment, my sister, and reflect on the last time you truly had a one-to-one conversation with your husband. By conversation, I mean an intelligent, educative, interesting conversation where points of views were exchanged, ideas bounced back and forth on a variety of different topics. When was the last time you had a conversation with him where you actually were right? Do you know how he would react when you are right and you disagree with him? Would he be okay with that, or would it annoy him, or would he like have the next conversation in 10 months' time? All these are pointers to help you understand how your husband is towards you. Read the signs before you cry a river later. The third indicator is the bedroom touch. Sexuality is a great indicator of a relationship status. Compare it with where you were, how things were when you were fine, when things were happy before the coming of the kids. I don't mean at the beginning of the marriage, as novelty factor can't be used as a reference, because when you were married newly fresh, yes, you had a lot of sex, that's a good thing, but that is not a good reference, because depending on age and health, once a week is good, okay-ish. But if more than that, then you will start asking yourself questions. But if your man has not touched you properly in 4 weeks' time, then something ain't right. If it's been more than 4 weeks, then you actually really need to get the ball rolling in trying to figure out what's going on here. Also, my dear sisters and my dear brothers, perhaps instead of responding to your sexual desires, because sometimes you make the moves on him, he responds with a short get done with it job, where you don't feel any connection. It's like a mechanical act, just like, okay, there it is, and just leave me alone. Or worse, if he starts providing excuses to you. So basically, if it's been a long time, since you had an intimate sexual relationship with your husband and he keeps keeping away from you, then definitely something ain't working at all. Inshallah, I shall cover more the topic about sex and intimacy and all this kind of stuff in Pep Talk 142, 43, and 47. And I will deal with this issue from different angles altogether. Fourth indicator, his phone. Without you letting him know or telling him, how does he treat his phone? Where does he keep it? How many security features does he have? And can you use it? How comfortable can you use it? How is he? Is he okay with you just picking it up at any time and calling or doing something wrong? Is he overprotective over it, or is he even a little protective? Is the phone always close to him? What apps does he have? When was the last time you picked his phone up in your hands and you kind of like just went through everything? Is this his only phone? Does he go out and speak out to somebody else? Names on it, etc. I will, inshallah, cover the technology topic in details in Pep Talk 153. What can you do when technology interferes and becomes your rival? And I'll deal more about these issues. Another hint, and that is too much displayed affection. This might come as a surprise, because as soon as he is home, he is perfectly nibbling on you, and you might be thinking, But isn't that supposed to be a good thing that he displays affection towards me? Well, depending on the rest of the equation. But if that is the only thing he does, and does a lot, then it's not a good thing, because this is indicative of an overcompensation and an ostentatious behavior, a behavior that is designed to impress. And in reality, what he is trying to do is put on a show. A make-believe show. He does everything he can to keep the good impression and illusion that he is very happy where he is now. But deep inside you, you know something is very wrong. And you hear others say things like, "What a perfect couple you guys are." He strives to make you believe that you have a relationship. And this is absolutely dangerous, because he is playing and manipulating, and also doing the utmost best to give the wrong impression to the people outside, especially if he tells you, "Don't tell anybody anything about what's going on here," and you are having the most miserable time in your life, then you know you are into something really, really bad, dangerous, and ugly. Number six, there are no remarkable moments in your relationship. The relationship just feels normal, nothing special, no highlights. You two don't have any exceptional memories together. There are no extraordinary feelings attached to anything that you do all the time you two spend together. This shouldn't be the case, my sister and my brothers, because love is an exceptional feeling. And if it feels anything less than amazing, then you are not really in love. You have reached the stage of complacency. He is complacent where he is, and you have to make do with that, and life goes on. This is not really, and it doesn't have to be something, my sisters, really big, like a huge event or moment. But even small, tiny things like the inside jokes and having cute nicknames for each other, it can mean a world, and it can mean a lot. Many times when I am working with couples and helping them and things like that, I ask them questions when the tension is up and they really don't like each other. I ask them a question, just think of a moment in your lives where you as a couple had the most awesomest time in your lives. Just think of it. And I get surprised by many of them is they don't have any. And this is really, really scary, because there has to be something to you both that you can relate to. Again, it doesn't have to be big, but something that can make you either remember a sweet memory or laugh together. Something that you see and make you think about your partner, something that makes you miss him, something that makes you say, "You know what, we used to have great, huge fun. And we can get back to that. We did it before. We can do it." The sad news is many couples don't have that extremely beautiful moment to go back to. And when problems strike, then they are stuck where they are. The next point is really something that you don't want to have in your relationship at all. And that is, there is a lot of confusion. If you have been married to someone for some time, then find yourself unsure of your husband's feelings, or find yourself spending hours contemplating, he loves me, he loves me not. But after you have spent notable time with your partner and you still can't really give substance to how you feel or if your husband truly loves you or not, and you're not trying to do anything about this issue and continue to profess your love and that you have everything under your hand and the control, then you are living in denial. You must not be confused. Confusion must not exist in your marriage at all. If it is there and you know it well deep inside you, only you can tell if you have confusion or not. No one else can tell you that. Number 8 is that serious discussions are off limits. Yes, I know this is an extension of bad communication, but a couple can have silly conversations as well as serious ones. You are wrong to think that a perfect relationship is one with no arguments and heated discussions. A happy couple talks about things that matter and things that don't. If your husband avoids having consequential conversations and only talks about things like the weather and just like really superficial stuff, then things are not looking too good. Arguments are healthy. There is something that is called rapport. Once you create it with your partner, you can fight for all it matters, but love never gets hurt, never gets attacked. But some people, they have these problems, especially in our culture close think, where the male must dominate everything, even in conversation. And if the woman doesn't agree with him on any subject, then the husband projects it on everything else in the marriage. I.e., if she disagrees with me on this topic, it means she's disobedient. It gets like to a level unbelievable of insecurity and threat. So my dear sisters and my brothers, really having heated discussions, conversations, arguments are healthy. It does not have to be every time he is the general and you are the sergeant. You take orders and you never retaliate with words. No. Again, anyway, so when the serious conversations are off limit, then you know you have a problem. The next point, people have made it like the foundation of a marriage, and that is the power struggle. That the woman must straight away, as soon as she gets married to a dude, that she must surrender all her will, all everything of hers to him for him to control. Because letting go of the couple's ego is essential for a sustainable and durable relationship. If you find yourself in a relationship, my dear sisters and my brothers, where he is always or always has to be right, that means there is a lack of love in the relationship. And that is because when you are in love, you are more flexible, more concerned about your partner's feelings being right, and being right doesn't always matter. If the husband thinks that the perfect outcome of an argument is the one where he is always right in the end, then it is not true love at all. Or if he is always considering that you are right in a conversation as a sign of disobedience, then this is absolutely not love at all. It is totally sad, my sisters and my brothers, that many husbands clearly do not care about their spouses. All they care about is being right, being man, being the one who is always correct. And this gets far more dangerous and manipulative when women and wives are deprived of their divine-given rights in the name of the very same religion that came to give them these rights. And it is enough for us that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in al-Bukhari, as he told Ummuna Aisha radiallahu anha, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِ بِيَدِي, by the one who holds my soul, إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمُ عِندَمَا تَكُونِينَ عَنِّي رَضِيَ, I know for sure when you are pleased with me and when you are displeased. Our mother Aisha turned to him, she goes, huh, how do you know that? And he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, عندما تقولي وَرَبُّ إِبْرَاهِيمُ, أو رَبِّ إِبْرَاهِيمُ, by the Lord of Ibrahim. And then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I know you are mad at me. That's why you don't want to even utter my name. But when you are pleased with me, you say, وَرَبِّ Muhammad, by the God of Muhammad. And that's when I know you are pleased with me. Look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He gave the right to his wife to be even, subhanAllah, not even mention his name. And he was okay with that because he was not threatened as so many males today are threatened. وَلَيَهَذُ بِاللَّهِ. In point number three, in the bedroom touch, I mentioned that the clear and apparent lack of sex in the couple is a problem. But here also is the other extreme, where there is an excessive sexual chemistry only. And what this means is that you as a couple, you are only too hot for each other into bed. When it comes to talking, communication, doing things together and starting projects or whatever, you are totally clueless or just not interested. But the only way you feel in synchronicity is by means of physical contact. This simply means you are in carnal relationship. And as soon as the infatuation dies, and it will die, so will the relationship. And usually, this is a blank, empty relationship that only evolves around the bedroom, and everything else is non-existent. Point number 11 is that it's easy to stay apart. When you are in love, you look so forward to seeing each other as often as you can. You write notes, you text, you speak, you can't stand being apart from each other. But if you get to the point where you are just happy being alone and indifferent that he's here or is not here, and then that is a striking point that your relationship is based on false love and you must do something about it. And obviously you can do readings. Alhamdulillah, we are on the time of the internet. You can go on the internet, research articles, read about them, and all that kind of stuff. The last point here that I want to pinpoint, and that is number 12, is when smile is lost from the home. When you are in true love, just their name would just spread a million smiles, million colors around you, and it lighten up your world, and everything really gets there for you. But if you have become really indifferent, he comes home, salam alaikum, acts tired, and he spends, you don't see, how do you see him smile, except just like to put a smile, fake smile in front of the child, and things like that, then here is the time for you to wake up, because if you don't do it, it's getting, and it is going to get very difficult. So here there are about 12 points that will help you see and find out when that phony tick is happening right in front of you. Perhaps it's happening now. And if it is, I strongly encourage you to start looking into making things work for you again. My sisters, do not wait on your husband to change. If you notice something has changed, bring him back on track and encourage him. Each of you knows your husband, and each of you knows how to manipulate. You gotta make sure that the relationship is no longer he is with you just because of the children. If there were no children, he would have gone. Or perhaps he just doesn't want the headaches of going and looking for a place to live. So he's staying with you because that is the best option for him. This is very unhealthy. Really, really totally unhealthy. Love is Allah's gift to humanity. Just like people are enjoying it all over the world, Muslims are also entitled to it. Do not let anyone take that from you. In the name of not a thing, Al-Islam never came to ask you to give up your right to love. In fact, Al-Islam encourages you to do that. Al-Islam encourages you to be feminine, not subservient, totally obedient, depersonified person. That is not what Allah wants from you. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that these points will help you get a better relationship with your husband. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this will help you rekindle your love with your husband and make you, bi'idhnillah, stay together, enjoy each other's company until that fateful day where we all will head to the graveyard. If you have any questions, comments, anything, just please do let me know. My name is Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. To join my group here on WhatsApp, just send me a message on 0044, this is England, 78764087 35. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.